Hello, I'm Viele, and today I would like to share this furry painting process with you while talking some devilish nonsense. I usually work from life or from reference, but sometimes things go wrong. I wanted to sketch this gentleman taking notes in bed and make a melancholic scene in grays, but his hands were hidden behind the headboard and constantly moving, so I gave him pause and removed the clothes for good measure. He's probably thinking, okay, I can learn to type with paws, but how on earth will I deposit my materials for thin film solar cells? My initial sketch was on tracing paper. I like sketching on tracing paper because it handles erasing and it is transparent, making it easier to transfer the sketch. I don't use a light table as I often paint on thick papers, 450 GSM or higher. This is Pastelmat paper and it is very thick. So what I do is I pierce the paper with a thick needle. My favorite is using a pair of compasses. But here I'm using pastel pencils that are thicker than usual graphite pencils. So I pierce the paper with the tip of an old pair of forceps. Then I stick the pencil into the dots, remove the tracing paper, connect the dots, and in the end, I can put the tracing paper back down to double check. Then I start blocking in the base color and smear the pigment with the applicators. Some of them are soft tools that come together with pen pastel, some are cheaper knockoffs, and both work the same. When you blend with your finger in pastel mat, you can't spread the pigment into a uniform thin layer like you can with these applicators. I do some finger blending afterwards when I need to partially preserve the strokes. Once the base color is down, I begin proper painting. Now I want to say a couple of words about this pastel palette that my mom brought me across half of Europe. It is a curated set by Olga Abramova, who is a master of painting nuance of light and color. So the palette is very neutral. Even the more saturated colors like the turquoise are quite subdued when compared to truly saturated versions of the same hue. This color selection is perfect for what I do, except for one point. It lacks true darks. The dark blue and the dark green are not very dark at all. Problems with the darks haunt pastels as a medium, even the pricier brands. I find it quite surprising, as there are good and relatively cheap dark pigments. In the Senelia line, there is an amazing purple-black color number 478, made of aniline black and manganese violet. And although aniline black is known for somewhat weaker light fastness than many other blacks, both the manufacturer's rating and my own test suggest that it's not too bad. But aniline black has tiny particle size, and I feel that this is part of the reason why the stick is softer than pretty much anything in the already very soft Senelia line. And it is not the good kind of softness. You instantly get too much pigment on the paper, and you can't create textures by lightly touching the paper. The other Senelia darks lean to the other extreme. They are very dry and crumbly, some more than others, and somewhat boring in color. The best affordable darks I tried were surprisingly from Paul Rubens. One is made of PBK-11, so Mars Black, and the other one is a mix of PBK-11 and Thalo Blue PB-15, if you trust their pigment codes. Both are very dark chromatic colors, soft, but not falling apart. But of course, they're not available open stock, so once I run out of them, and that is happening soon, I'm going to buy some Mars Black pigment powder and make my own blacks from the pigment and gum tragacanth. These pastels by Gamma are soft, yet not too soft. If I had to pick the closest match in terms of texture, it would be Unison. You can find the pigment codes for them, and most of them are reasonably light fast. I started testing the set, and while I can't show you my preliminary results, I saw minor changes in just two colors after one summer month, and surprisingly no change in the color that I found suspicious judging by its contents. But of course, time will tell. I'm working on a 35 by 50 centimeter sheet of paper, so the face is quite small and requires precision. For the most part of the painting process, the face was lagging behind, which is not great, as usually it is better to first cover the white of the paper to be able to judge color and values properly. But I was afraid of losing the sketch lines here. The glasses didn't make it easier. Paws turned out to be even more complicated than hands without a visual library or reference, so they turned out naive. But I actually like how they turned out. They remind me of funny-looking sphinxes of symbolist painters, and further, even funnier Renaissance lions. We can even think that he's Saint Anthony, tempted in the desert, but the demons are not just around him, but within, taking hold of his self-image and giving him body dysmorphia. Speaking of demons within, when I was reading Master and Margarita by Mikhail Bulgakov for the first time in my teenage years, I read it as a pure social satire without any supernatural elements. At that point, I could trace the allusions back only to Goethe and the New Testament. I had no clue about the heresies and the history of the Church and the development of the Christian doctrine. The only supernatural thing associated with that book was that I lost it 3 or 4 times in the most unusual places before I finally finished it. When I reread it in my mid-20s, I realized why I had such an impression. I had the most secular upbringing you can imagine, but of course I could not escape some pop culture version of Christianity. And according to those popular beliefs, the devil is not just the boss and a prisoner in hell who meets sinners after their death, but he is a pervasive entity which tempts from within. He gets into your mind, plants the seeds of sin, and then you either resist it or you don't. In Master and Margarita, however, Voland comes to Moscow, meets already corrupt people, and gathers the crop without ever planting the seed, so to speak. I should be wrapping up this video before I start spewing my favorite stories about the devil, but before that, I urge you to read Bulgakov's work, not just Master and Margarita. Like Arthur Conan Doyle, he was a medical doctor and had many realistic works, some of them depicting the medical practices of the day, and some more grotesque ones, again drawing upon his background in natural sciences. If you're still with me, please share your favorite fiction written by medical doctors, and don't forget to like this video. I'll see you in the next one.